Welcome back to the Kaiser Report. I'm Max Kaiser. Time now to return to our conversation with Simon Dixon. He's over there in the Isle of Man, of course, of Bank to the Future, author of the same book, Bank to the Future. Simon, welcome back.
Thanks for having me back again.
All righty. Now, Simon, in our first part of this conversation, you know, I heard again in your voice a very passionate description of the disruptive qualities of Bitcoin and crypto. And, you know, so often in this industry, people get caught up in the little petty kind of little wars that go on, this coin versus that coin, and they lose sight of the big picture, how disruptive this is to banking and to fiat money. So, you know, I think it's important, Simon, to once again preach the gospel to the people about how this is disrupting global banking. You were a banker. You came into crypto. Now you're riding the wave of this disruption. Preach, brother. Preach to the people.
Well, it is really important because we've had so much internal politics, as you know, Max, within our industry. Our industry has kind of turned on itself with our internal politics. But we do need to remember to put our best foot forward. And our best foot forward is exactly what this industry is doing. The fact of the matter is, Max, when we first started talking about this thing, when you had guests on and you introduced Bitcoin to the world for the first time on national TV, we were a tiny little thing. We had so many things against us. We were so likely to fail. We both spoke at that first Bitcoin conference, but yet here we are today, where pretty much wherever I go in the world, no matter how many people or what type of person I speak to, they have heard at least a Bitcoin. They may not know what it is. They may not know how to use it, but almost everybody in the world has heard a Bitcoin. That means that now there is something that everybody has heard of that they are going to discover at a different time why they need it. You know, the people in Cyprus didn't know that they needed Bitcoin until the bank stole their money. The people in Greece didn't know they needed Bitcoin until the ATM said there's no cash. The people in India didn't know that they needed Bitcoin until they had to queue outside their bank with their life savings in a bag and risk getting killed for their life savings because they had to put it through the banking system. Mexico didn't need that they needed Bitcoin until Donald Trump became president and crashed the value of 25%. The UK didn't know that they needed Bitcoin until Brexit happened and their currency and savings depleted 25% in the international market. We now have the very first time the ability for you to take, you know, to have digital cash, to own your own money, spend your own money, and have a monetary policy that rewards the saver rather than rewards the people taking on debt with traditional money. Now, within that, we've got lots of politics. We've got people that believe that Bitcoin is a savings account. We've got others that believe that it should be used as cash. And then you've got people coming along and saying, well, we can do this cheaper, faster, and better. But the point of the matter is that Bitcoin is the only one that's actually a store of value that's decentralized, that's able to actually fulfill that store of value role. And if something comes along and creates cheaper, faster cash, then great. That's the innovation that we're having. Ethereum comes along and creates a smart contract platform that turns out is actually disrupting the IPO market, Wall Street, and Silicon Valley. That doesn't mean that it competes with Bitcoin. This is all part of a greater ecosystem. And then EOS comes along and says that we can do this cheaper, you know, faster, better, more decentralized, less decentralized. The point of the matter is that Pandora's box is open. Bitcoin is this store of value, and we've got all this innovation that's being built around it. And that is a completely free market capitalist environment that regulators, when they try and control it, it ends up going somewhere else. So, you know, governments are making decisions all around the world how they're actually going to react to this technology. And that means that the dollar is less important in the world than it was because of Bitcoin. And because of Ethereum, the IPOs, Silicon Valley and Wall Street are less important in the world than they were before. And now on a global scale, people can participate in this this movement, this disruption. And at various different levels, people all around the world are going to be involved at different phases for different reasons. But the fact of the matter is we have global competition in some of the most entrenched interests that were built in the financial system that now need to be more honest, compete better, put together better systems. And then, you know, look at it when we have the next financial crisis. If we have a crisis, This time, they're not too big to fail. You can replace their money with a Fed coin or a cryptocurrency created at a central bank, and that can compete with Bitcoin. Bitcoin will win because it's a decentralized one that allows you to own it, spend it, and it encourages savings. But the fact of the matter is you now have all this disruption. You have all this competition. And when you first started the Kaiser Report, Max, and you were, you know, bringing, telling the world about all this corruption and problems, well, we now have the anti-force, and that is the crypto industry.
Yeah, I think a good point there is that the next crisis, and we know it comes because it comes as a result of the bailouts that of the preceding crisis. They never solve the problems. They just print more money. Now, you've brought up a lot of good points there. You've given talks around the world, and you have said on many occasions that you can see crypto and Bitcoin overtaking the venture capital market. And we've got a lot of inroads there too, Simon Dixon. Where are we on that timeline? Is this now eclipsing the venture capital market in your view? What do you think?
Well, it's already happening. The amount of money raised through ICOs last year. Now, you could have an opinion on them. So many of those were scams, unregistered securities, straight out Ponzi schemes. But the fact of the matter is more money was raised through ICOs than venture capital. But what happened? The world stopped relocating to Silicon Valley and begging VCs in order to give them money, and instead went to the world and said, do you agree with this value? And the whole world participated in that. Then what did venture capitalists do? Well, they came along and started investing in the Ponzi scheme scams and started getting discounts and trying to get discounts and you know, sell them to retail and at higher prices. And what happened is the venture capital industry started participating in this industry. So now the venture capitalists are just one of the participants in an industry that is much greater than their capital. And there's competition for that. So, and then the SEC comes along and says, well, we're going to clamp down on this stuff. Well, great. That means that America is now the worst place in the world in order to raise finance for your business if you're trying to do something in the blockchain and crypto sector and issue one of these tokens. So, you know, that's the venture capital industry is not disrupted. They are just one of the players. They're one of the investors that compete for other money and other investors. And they're all trying to scramble around and adjust and figure out, oh, wow, well, now we can actually have secondary market liquidity on our investments. And if this starts moving around the regulated route, well, you have regulated securities. You have different jurisdictions that will support cryptocurrencies. And then you'll have completely decentralized, out of the control of everyone. And those markets are going to exist, and people just need to decide, like it, hate it, it's here, it's coming, and it's not going away.
Now, let's talk about Back to the Future for a second, because you've been on the forefront of this industry now since practically it's an inception, and you had an ATS license, the Alternative Trading System license, through a company you owned called Venovate. Now, you sold that to Coinbase. What can you tell us about the deal? What does it say for the future in regards to U.S. investors? So this is the big question. You know, the U.S. is being cut out of a lot of deals because of the regulations in the U.S. So with this deal with Coinbase that you've been involved with, how is that going to reshape the regulatory framework, if at all? Your thoughts, Simon?
Just to get that factually correct. So we were a shareholder in Keystone Capital Corporation that was then sold to Coinbase, and Coinbase is looking to enter the securities market in order to do that. Now, the interesting thing right now, and this touches upon many of the things that we were actually speaking about, is that U.S. legislation is not necessarily fit for purpose for the token market. For example, there's things in U.S. legislation that states if you have an ATS, you can't actually display the price and have an order book. Now, the crypto market is used to order book and displaying prices, you know, and because if you do have an order book and are displaying the prices, then you need to be registered as a national securities exchange. And also, in order to sell those exemptions and allow those, you know, those markets to be non-public companies and still be able to sell them as they have been, there needs to be a one-year lock-in according to U.S. securities law. So combine those forces, and you've actually got a very inappropriate legislative structure and regulatory structure in order to operate what the crypto market is used to. Now, the whole world is focusing on the US, obviously, because the SEC is the most vocal regulator. But around the world, they're putting fit-for-purpose regulations, and they don't have these hangovers and restrictions from being, you know, the leading financial market in the world, whereas someone else is getting the opportunity to leapfrog. You know, we saw that with, you know, M-Pesa just leapfrogging the banking system, going straight to mobile money. Well, other jurisdictions, they're leapfrogging securities, IPOs and exchanges, and going straight to where we want to be. And that's what Bank to the Future has been working on. And we've been asking the questions, you know, is focusing on the US the right strategy? Is that the right approach? Well, it depends where they go from here and what happens next. But if not, there's other jurisdictions willing to build fit for purpose and do this in the way that the crypto market is wants it done.
Let me ask you about, you know, Africa. You know, you mentioned M-Pesa in Africa, and of course we know BitPesa. We've been involved in helping to finance that company. Recently on Bank of the Future, our good friends at BitMari were able to raise some funds. They are now got a banking license in Zimbabwe. So, I mean, this is part of the great thing about this industry, Simon, is not only are you disrupting the banking industry, as you stated, you know, in your book when you started out, but you're also changing dynamics in the global finance in a big way. So Africa potentially could be the whole continent, certainly countries within Africa, can leapfrog ahead of all these other territories, and it could be a really interesting success story. You would know better. What do you see there?
Absolutely. And, you know, we're geographically diversified. We think that crypto has its unique position in many different geographies. You know, I was just speaking from, you know, with I think you spoke to Sunny from Unicoin recently, another company, you know, we were investing in and in the early days. And, you know, in India, the banks come along and state that the banks are no longer allowed to work with cryptocurrency exchanges. So how does an exchange like Unicoin react to like that? Well, they state, well, thank God, we don't have a banking license. Let's create some decentralized technology. Let's look at different opportunities. Well, let's look at the cash to crypto market. If the banks aren't allowed to participate, then regulations are stating that we can participate. Now the banks can't compete with us. And so a lot of these announcements that you see are often interpreted as negative, but actually have can have positive results when the entrepreneurs in this industry are nimble enough to adjust to the environment.
All right, Simon, we got to cut her off there, but a fantastic message. Just work around it. The entrepreneurs in crypto are the best, and the fiat money is in retreat. Simon Dixon, thanks for being on the Kaiser Report.
Thank you, Max.
Well, that's going to do it for this edition of the Kaiser Report with me, Max Kaiser, and Stacey Herbert. I'd like to thank our guest, Simon Dixon of Bank to the Future. If you want to reach us on Twitter, it's Kaiser Report. Until next time, bye, y'all.